ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। नमः ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंदा। हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्णा हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम रामा हरे हरे। We have been discussing about sacrifice. We started this yesterday. So in the Bhagavad Gita, in the third chapter, Krishna describes work has to be done as sacrifice in order to become free from material bondage. So Krishna continues to explain one more important aspect of sacrifice. In the 13th verse, he says, Yajna shishta ashinaha santaha muchyante sarva kil vishaihi bhunjate te tu agham papa ye pachanti atmakaranat. What does this verse mean? This verse means santaha, the devotees of the Lord, are released from all kinds of sins. Muchyante sarva kil vishaihi, because they eat food which is offered first for sacrifice. Yajna shishta means remnants of food offered for sacrifice. In other words, nothing but prasadam, Krishna prasadam. Others who prepare food for personal sense enjoyment, ye pachanti atma karanat, such people eat only sin. Bhunjate te agham papa. So if somebody does not perform sacrifice and partake of the remnants of food offered in sacrifice, then simply eating food, simply by cooking something and just eating it, that is going to result in eating only sin, sinful reactions, bondage, suffering. So this we have to understand, the importance of sacrifice. Not only sacrifice as an action is itself free from reactions, but even for our subsistence we have to eat something. So that eating also is possible to be done in such a way that eating itself will free us from sinful reactions, will purify our heart. If we eat remnants of food offered in sacrifice. So what kind of sacrifice can we perform? The traditional Vedic sacrifices, as was described yesterday, Pancha Mahayajna, sacrifice to the Devatas, sacrifice to the Rishis, sacrifice to the general living beings, sacrifice to the forefathers, and sacrifice to general human beings. These five kinds of sacrifices are necessary because we are taking benefit. When we live in this world, we take benefit from all these five categories of personalities. So we owe them, we are in debt with them. So to clear that debt, the scriptures say you have to offer them sacrifice. But since such Vedic sacrifices are not practically possible in this Kali Yuga, in our modern age. Therefore, the scriptures and the Acharyas instruct us to perform Sankirtan Yajna. In Sankirtan Yajna, our method of doing sacrifice is the method of doing devotional service. So therefore, Srila Prabhupada says, the devotees of the Lord, here the word Santa is used in this verse. Yajna Shishta Ashinaha Santaha. Santa means devotees. Now, how does Santa refer to devotees specifically? Because in the Brahma Samhita, it is said, Yajna Shishta Ashinaha Santa. Sorry. Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena Santaha Sadaiva Hrudayeshu Vilokayanti. Those who are devotees, they actually have got their eyes smeared with the ointment of love for Krishna. And therefore, they are always able to actually remain in Krishna consciousness. Always able to remain in Krishna consciousness. And such devotees, what is their characteristic as described in this verse of the Bhagavad Gita? Devotees are accustomed to performing sacrifice in 9 different ways. Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnoho, Smaranam, Padasevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakyam, Atmanivedanam. The 9 ways of doing devotional service, 9 methods of rendering devotional service to the Supreme Lord, 9 methods of practicing bhakti as described in the Srimad Bhagavatam. It begins with Shravanam Kirtanam. It begins with hearing and chanting. So that hearing and chanting specifically is performed according to the teachings of Lord Chaitanya in the form of japa and kirtan. Japa means to chant the Hare Krishna mantra and hear our own chanting. Whatever we chant, we have to hear. That is japa. And kirtan is we sing, not just chant. It is specifically singing according to a particular melody, and it is repeated. So kirtan is generally done in a group, whereas japa is done individually. In either case, one has to hear and chant the holy name of the Supreme Lord, especially as it is given in the form of the Hare Krishna mantra. So, devotees engage specifically in hearing and chanting the holy name of the Supreme Lord, and for their subsistence, they actually offer food to Krishna and take the remnants as prasadam. So, devotees accept yajna shishta. Remnants of food offered in sacrifice by worshipping Krishna, offering Krishna some food items. And what does Krishna accept? Krishna accepts patram pushpam phalam toyam yome bhaktya prayachati. He accepts vegetarian category of foodstuff. Since bhakti means offering with devotion, therefore we offer Krishna whatever Krishna is asking. We cannot offer Krishna what we like to offer. So therefore it is said in this category, leaf, flower, fruit. So basically vegetarian foodstuff has to be offered to Krishna, and the remnants of such offering may be accepted by those who have done the offering. And this is the way devotees accept yajna shishta, remnants of food offered in sacrifice. And in this way, devotees become purified. मुच्यन्ते सर्व किल विषयी. एनीबडी हु एक्सेप्ट कृष्ण प्रसादम इंस्टेड ऑफ जस्ट ईटिंग एनी फूड, इफ दे एक्सेप्ट ओनली कृष्ण प्रसाद, इफ दे ईट ओनली कृष्ण प्रसाद, और एनीबडी हु परफॉर्म्स इवन द ट्रेडिशनल वैदिक सैक्रिफाइस, दे ऑफर सम फूड इन द सैक्रिफाइस एंड दैट फूड इज द रेमिनेंट्स ऑफ सच ऑफरिंग इज एक्सेप्टेड बाय स्ट्रिक्ट फॉलोअर्स ऑफ द वैदिक injunctions or the Vedic directions. So, by eating remnants of food offered in sacrifice or by eating Krishna Prasadam, one can become free from all contamination, material contamination in the heart. Whereas those who don't do so, simply prepare something or cook something or just eat something without making any offering, either in sacrifice or in the form of worshipping Krishna, they don't perform any offering to the Supreme Lord, then they are eating only sin. That means they are becoming more implicated. Already by birth itself in this world, everyone has got some load of reactions, sinful reactions. And by simply eating food which is not offered to Krishna, which is not offered in sacrifice to Vishnu, such food also simply increases the sinful reaction. So it means increasing suffering. So therefore, it is highly recommended that one should actually offer food to Krishna, either by the method of worshipping Krishna and offering food to him, or by performing the Vedic sacrifices, either way. There is a nice example in the life of one great saint, Narada. All of you are familiar with Narada. He is the greatest of devotees who constantly travels and tries to make others devotees, tries to preach about bhakti to whoever he meets. That is his primary engagement. So Narada describes to his disciple Vyasadeva, in his previous life, Narada was born as the son of a maidservant, because somehow he was cursed to be born as a Dasi Putra. Very insignificant birth, very insignificant parentage. And he was living with his mother in the forest. And it so happened that when he was a small boy, some great devotees, pure devotees called Bhakti Vedantas, they were traveling through that forest. And it so happened that while they were traveling through the part of the forest where Narada Muni was staying with his mother, that time the Chaturmasya began, the rainy season began. The 4 months of the rainy season, especially in India, the months from June onwards, June, July, August, September, these 4 months generally is famous for rains. So in the rainy season, the 4 months of the rainy season, the traveling saintly persons, Parivrajakas, especially those in the renounced order, who sannyasis who keep traveling and preaching, they stop traveling in the rainy season and they stay in one place, and in that place they execute all their spiritual activities or spiritual duties. So these Bhakti Vedantas, at the beginning of the rainy season, they stopped by in that part of the forest where Narada Muni was staying, the small boy was staying with his mother. And his mother was just like a maid servant engaged in some menial service. So when the saintly persons were staying there, Narada Muni's mother was engaged in serving them, in doing some menial service to the saintly persons. So the small boy would accompany his mother, and also he would also help his mother in doing some cleaning. So once, when his mother was not there, he got an opportunity to clean up after the sages had prepared some food offered to the Supreme Lord and taken prasadam. Then he got a chance to clear their dishes and he even got a chance to wash those dishes. So this way, when he had a chance to clean up what they had left behind, once he took their permission and ate some remnants of prasadam which they had left behind in their plate. So after eating that, there was a very big change in the heart of this boy, small boy. He became very, very serious. He gave up his childish proclivities of simply engaging in some play, and he got attracted to those saintly persons about what they were doing when they were assembling together every day and discussing something. So he would also go and sit and try to hear what they were discussing. Gradually, in their association, he developed attraction for hearing from them while they were discussing subject matter of Krishna, Krishna Katha. So he kept on hearing, serving them. In this way, he became advanced in Krishna consciousness without formally undergoing any kind of Gurukul training, any kind of education, formal education, without any of that. Simply by their association, especially by eating the remnants of foodstuff left behind by them, the prasadam. So Narada says, because of eating the remnants of that food, he gradually became as pure-hearted as those saintly persons, as those Bhaktivedantas. And he developed the same taste that they had for hearing and chanting and discussing about Krishna Katha. The same taste he developed. And in their association, he also began to hear in their association about Krishna. And gradually, as those saintly persons, at the end of their stay there, 4 months, what did they do? They saw this boy became so interested and so very eager to learn. They actually imparted to him the most confidential knowledge of devotional service to Krishna. In the scriptures, there are so many descriptions about the Supreme Lord, about God, about the Absolute Truth. But among the different descriptions of the Absolute Truth, there are 3 different levels of this transcendental knowledge about the Absolute Truth. The first level is the level of describing the Absolute Truth as the all-pervading impersonal Brahman. This impersonal Brahman is nothing but the energy of the Supreme Lord, which is spread everywhere and which is manifesting, especially the impersonal Brahman manifesting as the material world. The material world. And in this material world, we don't see God directly, but everything that is there, that this material world is made of, is actually energy of Krishna in the form of the material energy. So Krishna's own energy in this form of this material energy is his impersonal Brahman feature, impersonal Brahman feature. So that impersonal Brahman feature is the confidential knowledge of the Vedic literature. Then more confidential knowledge is when, by cultivating this transcendental knowledge from the Vedic literature and understanding beyond ordinary descriptions of ordinary things in the Vedic literature, beyond descriptions of this material world, the description of the absolute truth as the impersonal Brahman, the source of this material world, behind this material world, is that impersonal Brahman, which is the absolute truth. More confidential knowledge is knowledge of the Supreme Lord present in this world as Paramatma, having entered into everything that is created. This is more confidential knowledge, knowledge of the absolute truth as explained in the Vedic literature in terms of the absolute truth being present everywhere as Paramatma. As Paramatma, he is the controller, he is the maintainer, he is the provider, he is the one who actually regulates everything. So he has entered into everybody's heart, he has entered into every material atom as Paramatma. And it is he only who is actually conducting all the affairs of this material existence in the form of Paramatma. So this is more confidential knowledge. But most confidential knowledge of the absolute truth in the Vedic literature is knowledge of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Bhagavan. The Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is actually the source of both Brahman and Paramatma. And that way, the source of everyone and everything, ultimate source of everything, as described in the Bhagavad Gita, Aham Sarvasya Prabhavo, or described in the Vedanta Sutra as Janmadhyasya Yataha. So this description is the most confidential knowledge in the Vedic literature, the description of the Supreme Absolute Truth as the personality of Godhead, Vishnu or Krishna or Narayana. So that description is very, very, very confidential. And the Bhakti Vedantas, those sages who were staying in that part of the forest where Narada Muni was staying with his mother, a small boy, when they saw this boy so seriously interested in hearing what they were discussing, then they took compassion upon this boy and actually instructed him in bhakti, in the knowledge of the Supreme Personality of God, Krishna. And in this way, they taught him how to execute devotional service, bhakti yoga. And then they left. After 4 months, they left that place. But Narada, what happened? He actually was staying with his mother, because he had no other shelter, small boy. But one day when his mother had gone to milk a cow, because she was doing some menial service to maintain herself, she had gone to milk a cow in somebody's house. And on the way back, she was bitten by a snake. And instantly, that was a very poisonous snake, and instantly she died of the snake bite, poisonous snake bite. And then when Narada, when he came to know that his mother has died by the snake bite, he thought that it is the Lord's mercy upon him, that because he was attached to this mother and therefore he was not able to actually, due to that attachment, properly practice bhakti yoga with exclusive dependence on the Supreme Lord. Now that his only other shelter in this world, his mother, was taken away, he took it like the mercy of the Lord in making him completely depend exclusively on the Supreme Lord. Because bhakti yoga means to understand Krishna as the only maintainer, as the only provider, as the only source, only Lord, only worshipable deity, everything. Krishna is everything for the devotee. So, this way Narada Muni thought that Krishna wants me to actually go closer to him. And therefore, he started walking away from that place towards north. Generally, those who want to practice spiritual life, they go to a holy place. And generally in India, holy place means very easy to find one such holy place in the Himalayas. For the Indian continent, subcontinent, the Himalayas in the north are in the north. So he started walking north and he kept on walking till he came to a suitable spot for staying and actually practicing this bhakti yoga, meditation on the Supreme Lord Krishna. So as taught by the sages, he actually began his meditation, and within some time he was able to actually have a very, very brief darshan of the Supreme Lord within the heart, who is seated in the heart as Paramatma, by his meditation as taught by the sages. And then what happened? He had a very brief glimpse of a darshan of the Supreme Lord. His joy multiplied millionfold and he became extremely ecstatic. And then for a brief moment after the darshan, he lost sight of the Lord in the heart. Then he tried to again go back into that state of meditation to again have darshan. He tried in so many ways to somehow get darshan once again of the Lord in the heart. But how much ever he tried, he was not successful in getting darshan for a second time. He was not able to. So then he became very, very morose and disappointed. That's, he's describing that as somebody gets a very, very valuable treasure, a poor man gets a very valuable treasure, but after just getting it in the hand, he again loses it. So how does a person feel? A poor man who has somehow got a very big valuable treasure and then immediately loses it. In a short time, he loses that. And then he searches for that and he does not get back. He is not able to find it again. So like that, Narada Muni began to feel that I have lost something very, very valuable. I am not able to get back. What do I do now? So while he was having this kind of feeling, disappointed and dejected as having lost the darshan of the Supreme Lord within the heart, then he heard a voice, unseen voice, speak. So it was the Supreme Lord who did not give him darshan a second time, but who spoke to Narada, "My dear Narada, it is very difficult for people who have not perfected their practice to actually have any kind of darshan of the Supreme Lord. It is not possible. But just to increase your eagerness to attain me, I have just given you a glimpse of the darshan of my transcendental form within your heart. So now I advise you to continue your devotional activities, and in this way, if you continue till the end of this life, then you will achieve all perfection by my grace." So then Narada, then the unseen voice stopped and everything became silent around Narada in that sacred place. So then, as advised by the Supreme Lord, he continued his devotional activities without endeavoring to see the Lord. In fact, it is said in the scriptures, one should not try to see the Lord by some means of practice of some yoga or devotional service or meditation or whatever. One should actually act in such a way or perform the activities in such a way that the Lord will be pleased to give darshan by himself. It is always the case that one cannot see God by one's own endeavor, but one is able to see God only when God himself, Krishna himself, reveals. For God to actually, Krishna to reveal himself to anybody, it's very, very, very easy. But for us to see Krishna, that is not easy. In this way, Narad Muni continued, and in the next birth, he quit his body at the end of that life. And in the next birth, he was born as the great Narad Muni, the son of Brahma and perfect devotee. He was born as a perfect devotee because he had already practiced devotional service and he had perfected himself. So the Lord gave him the memory of his previous life was retained. And he actually, since then, he says he's simply traveling and preaching the glories of the Lord, instructing everybody to become a devotee. So, this particular description of the change in Narad Muni in his previous life as a small boy without any formal training or education or any kind of special practice, simply by taking the remnants of prasadam, especially the remnants of prasadam which is left behind by pure devotees, that is very, 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 very potent. So this power of this prasadam is very nicely illustrated in this description by Narad Muni about his previous life. So we should actually, and this verse also Krishna says that by eating prasadam, you are able to actually become purified, and that's a fact. So I'll try to answer some questions. Yesterday, here are the questions. In third chapter, in the 16th verse purport, it is said about yajnas, indirectly it is the practice of Krishna consciousness, because when one masters the performance of yajnas, one is sure to become Krishna conscious. So why does it say indirectly in that purport? Here Prabhupada is describing in this purport that either one can directly worship Krishna and become Krishna conscious, or one can perform the yajnas mentioned in the Vedas, which gradually elevate one to Krishna consciousness step by step. Because the yajnas mentioned in the Vedas begin with worship of the demigods, the devatas, who are supplying us our necessities. Indra, Agni, Varuna, Vayu, etc. So we offer sacrifice to these devatas because we are directly receiving everything from them. So in that way, gradually one comes to understand the chief of all these devatas is Vishnu. He is the chief of all the devatas. He is the supreme lord. He is the master of all the devatas. He is the lord of all lords. And then one gradually comes to understand that ultimately sacrifice is to be offered to Vishnu. So gradually one comes to that point by beginning with offering sacrifices to the devatas. So therefore, when one performs Vedic sacrifices as prescribed in the Vedas, one should understand that it's ultimately aimed at coming to the point of worshipping Vishnu as the chief of all the devatas, as the lord of all the devatas, as the ultimate beneficiary or enjoyer of all sacrifices. Even when you offer to the devatas, they keep a small portion, which is their allotted quota of the offerings and the sacrifice, and they offer the rest, the lion's share of the sacrifice, or the major portion to Vishnu, because they also cannot take everything that is offered in sacrifice. Through them, actually, we are offering to Vishnu only. So therefore, Prabhupada says, indirectly it is a practice of Krishna consciousness, because when master the performance of yajnas, one is sure to become Krishna conscious gradually. But if one directly takes to Krishna consciousness, then one can actually directly worship Krishna and directly become, very quickly become Krishna conscious without the need for gradually making progress. Then the next part of this question is, so are the yajnas or homa performed in the temple as per this statement? No. The yajnas or homas performed in the temple are directly worshipping Krishna or Narasimha or any of the deities. We are directly worshipping Krishna. We are offering sacrifice directly to Krishna. And our main method of sacrifice, even if we whether we perform fire sacrifice or we perform the sacrifice of chanting the holy name, in all cases, every sacrifice is accompanied by chanting of the holy name. Even when we do Narasimha Yajna, we are actually chanting the holy name of Lord Narasimha. When we do any fire sacrifice in the temple, we always chant the holy name of the Supreme Lord. So all sacrifices in this age are to be accompanied by, if not directly chanting the holy name, simply chanting the holy name itself is the sacrifice recommended in this Kali Yuga. But if even if somebody performs a fire sacrifice, even a fire sacrifice, for it to be successful, it has to be accompanied by chanting of the holy name of the Supreme Lord. So in the temple, in our temple, all the sacrifices, including every fire sacrifice, is accompanied by chanting of the holy name of the Supreme Lord. So that way, these sacrifices are directly bhakti yoga practice or performance. What is meant by illusory energy of the Lord that is referred to in 6th verse of the 3rd chapter? Illusory energy of the Lord. Okay, what is said here is, if somebody makes a show of doing some meditation externally, but inside his mind is not fixed on the Supreme Lord, mind is actually engaged in some sense enjoyment, or mind is not actually properly focused on the object of meditation, the Supreme Lord, then such a person is called by Krishna as a pretender. His so-called meditation is useless. It is useless. So Prabhupada describes in the purport that even if somebody speaks big philosophy but does not properly fix the mind and within his heart, such a person does not actually dedicate his consciousness, his attention, his mind to the service of the Supreme Lord, does not fix his mind on Krishna, then such a person, even if he speaks philosophy, he has no benefit of having studied some scriptures or having understood or having memorized some verses in the Vedas or reciting some shlokas. All that is useless, because what happens, because of his making a show of devotion or show of meditation, at the same time inside his heart, he is just interested in sense enjoyment, in some material enjoyment. Such a person, he is deluded by Maya, by illusory energy. So the illusory energy will take away the real effect of his studying the Vedic scriptures. He will not get any benefit having studied or having memorized some Vedic mantras. All such chanting and speaking philosophy or studying the scriptures are useless. So therefore, one has to be careful not to make an external show and within the heart secretly indulge in some sinful activity or some sense enjoyment. No, one has to within the heart definitely be aiming at giving up all kinds of material sense enjoyment. That is the most important requirement of spiritual life. As long as we continue to try to enjoy materially, we cannot progress spiritually. We can't even begin spiritual life. Even though externally we may be doing some rituals or some show of devotion, that is useless. So we have to give up such material enjoyment on the path of spiritual progress. That is what is explained here. I'll stop here. Hare Krishna. Tomorrow we will not be having this session, because we are celebrating the temple Narasimha Jayanti. So Narasimha Jayanti will be broadcast. The program of celebration of Narasimha Jayanti will be broadcast. So we will not be having this session tomorrow. We will continue day after tomorrow at the same time. Hare Krishna.